Back to 5 Live 224, and we talked about, this is Jasmine Simpkins. She is from Hip Hollywood. We're going to talk right now a little more in depth about the R. Kelly docuseries that was on Lifetime. But first, we're going to show you a clip from this morning's show where Eric Spillman kind of went in depth about the docuseries and the reactions that people have been having. Regular, normal people and celebrities in Hollywood that are finally voicing their opinion on it as well.
He's got a smooth voice and he's won multiple Grammys, but in this six-part documentary called Surviving R. Kelly, numerous people come forward to accuse the pop star of being controlling and both physically and sexually abusive. And in some cases, the victims say the abuse began when they were just teenage girls.
He would break you down. He would turn around and say, "I'm the only one that loves you. I'm the only one who cares about you." I was mentally drained.
Robert feels as if he's invincible. I can't be touched. And in hindsight, in society, we kind of made him feel that way.
In 2002, Kelly was charged with child pornography for a videotape that showed him allegedly having sex with an underage girl. He was acquitted in that case. And in 2017, he was accused of having a sexual relationship with a teen. He denied it was true. Now, musicians Kelly have worked with, or people that he's, other singers are saying, that they're denouncing him based on that documentary. Singer Neo says music is important, but it's not more important than protecting our children. He called on people to mute R. Kelly's music. R&B singer Tank says the documentary made him sick to his stomach, and actress Jada Pinkett Smith on her Instagram says she cannot understand why sales of Kelly's music have spiked online since the documentary came out.
And I'm having a really difficult time understanding why. And I really don't want to believe that it's because black girls don't matter enough. Or is that the reason?
Kelly's lawyer says the documentary is filled with false accusations. TMZ is reporting the singer plans to launch a website called survivinglies.com with the goal of, he says, exposing all of his accusers as liars.
Okay, Jasmine, welcome to 5 Live. You're our kind of resident entertainment guru. The first thing I want to start with is what he's doing to counter these accusations. It seems asinine.
You took the word out of my mouth. I was going to say asinine. Really, I was. The fact that he would even try and now use, you know, the title from Surviving R. Kelly and now calling it Surviving Lies. I just think that he doesn't realize the severity of what's going on. I, for the life of me, don't know what it's going to take for him to realize that you have damaged a lot of lives and you have to stop. You just have to stop. Like, that's the first thing. Mm-hmm. Just stop. Let the girls go and stop and get help. Period.
And you say let the girls go because if you haven't watched, at the end of, it's like 6 hours of this docuseries, there are two girls that are basically unaccounted for. Their parents haven't seen them in 2-3 years that are allegedly with him now.
Yeah. Well, there's two girls who we know of. But if you've read any of the articles, BuzzFeed kind of kicked this whole thing off in 2017, talking about the fact that there was upwards of 6 girls who were living in this house in Atlanta.
Does he brainwash them? Is that how it works?
We don't necessarily know exactly the tactics that he's using, but obviously he's a master manipulator. And we are getting girls who are 17, 18, even 19 at that point in your life. You're so impressionable. And when you meet a celebrity, a man that you love his music, and now he takes a liking to you, he can tell you anything. And next thing you know, it's been 3 years and you haven't talked to your parents. So,
and speaking of loving music, what do you think about the people who are now going and listening to R. Kelly's music? Is it more of a curiosity? Like, I wonder what songs he has?
I think we have to understand this, that a lot of the people who are watching this documentary, this is their first time really getting an understanding of R. Kelly's life. You know the music, but in 1999, you might have been, what, 2 or 3 years old. So we've got millennials who are getting a firsthand education in who he is and then who he was. So I think it's curiosity more than anything. And they're wondering, did I miss something? Or AJ, nothing but a number. I remember that song where my mom played it. Yeah. You want to go back and listen to it. You want to go listen to the lyrics. I don't know if they're downloading it and like, oh, yes, you know, I want to listen out of nostalgia. For out of nostalgic reasons, I think it's just the curiosity in us all who are now going back to see if there were things that we just did not notice during that time.
A lot of the documentary does discuss that a lot of his songs were him telling on himself.
Trapped in the Closet, I think, is the biggest. I mean, if you were to watch that, I was even tempted to go and look for it again.
Yeah. That's because what I'm saying. If you're going to go do it, it's because you want to prove, okay, they're right.
It's not a new
right.
fan base.
No, right. It's not necessarily a new fan base, but it is a younger fan base who I think are reacclimating themselves mm-hmm. or getting a better understanding of what it is that everyone's talking about, because it has been trending for days. Mm-hmm. So you might not have been old enough to buy the album. You didn't right. have 12 Play. Mm-hmm. You didn't have TP2 or 3. But now you're like, wait a minute. You know, let me go and listen to these songs.
Well, the biggest wait a minute is, why isn't this man in jail?
You know, it's really sad to say, but I think after the trial in 2008, mm-hmm. I think he became better. He became a better predator. I think that he was
not a better person.
Not a better person. Okay. No, this did not change R. Kelly for the better. No. What happened was he learned how to get away with his actions. He learned that if I'm going to have girls, they've got to be of consenting age. Mm-hmm. If I'm going to get into this type of lifestyle, I've got to have a team around me who's going to really buffer and protect me. I think that he just used it as ammunition and ignition, for lack of a better word, to become what he is now. And it's if you watched even parts 5 and 6, it became darker and darker,
mm-hmm.
and the
really
reality of it became scary almost.
And it's because those times in the later episodes, it's 2016, 2017, and these girls, one of the things you said, he became a better predator, and it's very apparent. He'll pick a 17-year-old about to turn 18 so that when her parents are looking for her, she doesn't have to answer her phone in a couple months.
Yeah.
It's very calculated and disturbing.
A lot of people, too, online, you look at social media, a lot of people were surprised, though. They were like, why is everyone so shocked? These are things we knew. But that's to your point, I think for the fan of R. Kelly, what you had to realize when you watched those last final episodes is that I can no longer step in the name of love while there are girls mm-hmm. who are still currently in 2019 perhaps living with him, who have been detached from their families mm-hmm. and who probably are being abused. You know, the things that these girls said that he was doing to them is very abusive. And so as a fan, you had to take a stance and say, I can't like his music because in doing so, I'm condoning behavior that he is currently doing. This is not 10 years ago when he was on trial. This is right now. And I think that's why the movement has to go somewhere. We have to do something to stop him.
That was going to be my next question. What is the next step? He's just still out there.
I mean, he's been releasing music.
Yeah.
People are still
creating counter accounts. It's just so strange that he can still move so freely in this society.
I'm hoping what this does is it creates not only just awareness, but you have people who can actually do something. You saw on The View, one of the hosts, Sunny Houston, how she mm-hmm. said that she used to actually work in this, you know, type of environment where she was helping defend girls who had been preyed on by older men, and she used to convict child molesters, and mm-hmm. so she wants to do something. She really wants to help the survivors and also girls who may not be speaking out, but, you know, let's help them to really be able to prosecute him, because she thinks jail time is still something that can happen. And so I think people like her and people who have the wherewithal to put him behind bars, I think that's what's going to have to happen. We cannot keep turning a blind eye to what's going on.
Right, there needs to be an essence of shame, right? Like, we can't keep buying his music, which I think after this, safe to say, might not happen. And people need to stop collaborating with him, which after this, let's hope that happens. But there's only one big name in the music industry who took part in this documentary. So do you think now, after it's fully done and completed, we are going to see the backlash from his own?
I hate to say this, but the reality is that, and we all know this, the music industry has been a huge environment for misogyny.
Right.
It's overly sexualized. Mm-hmm. You saw rap videos, hear lyrics that don't speak about women in a very, you know, nice and lovely way.
Right.
And I think that it was that kind of environment that was going on in the 90s that created this this kind of environment where artists felt like it was okay
protected.
Date young girls and have them wear scantily clad, you know, outfits in their videos. And so I think it was a part of the culture. And so when you don't hear other artists talking, I think it's primarily because they were a part of that culture. Mm. And R. Kelly is one, I think, of many.
Interesting.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, are you surprised at anyone that has come to either the realization or on the other end, people are coming to his defense, which I think is absolutely insane.
I think the people, again, who are coming to his defense are people who understand that that was what was going on, and they kind of think it's normal. Mm. But I think if they saw the documentary in its totality, they have to walk away going, right, okay, I was doing a little some of this, but not all of this.
Right.
And now we've got to do something to get him to stop. Because really, for him at this age, he's what, 51? To continue these kinds of practices, it's out of hand.
I mean, it's always gross. It's always been gross. But to think of a 51-year-old man preying on a 17-year-old and, like, manipulating her in that way, it's disgusting.
He deserves jail time.
Yeah. You just hope that that is what happens. These trials tend to take years and years and years. But the sooner that we get him and prosecute, is the better. So we'll see what happens with that. Jasmine, thank you so much for coming in and talking to us. We will be right back.